She has served in Commonwealth Educational Media Center for Asia, KEMCA, New Delhi, for 2 years. She has served at CIT NCERT for around 5 years, and currently, ma'am is working as a visiting assistant professor at MIT ADT University, Pune. So, ma'am, I welcome you to the session, and I would request you to start the session.
Thank you, Diksha, but I would request that introduction is enough once. It is not required twice and thrice. Thank you so much. Very good evening to all the participants. Since now, yesterday, we've also taken a session with you, and one session I've also taken in the breakout rooms. So we are very much aware the way we go about in training. Now, you have learned a lot about different tools, need for content creation, and how to create content. In terms of from script to screen, you have seen all the process. So there is one important aspect related to it is the evaluation. When we create any kind of content once, there is a need to evaluate it, whether it is suitable for the learner or not. Even though when we start creating the content, then also we keep evaluating at different stages. But evaluating towards the end is also a kind of mandatory task. In CIET also, when the content is produced, so first of all, the topic is identified and discussed with the faculty members whether this should go into production or not. Second is, after script is written, a committee, which is called script reviewing committee, they sit together, 5 to 7 people sit together, subject experts also join in from Department of NCERT. And they discuss the script, and the script is reviewed at different levels, and the comments are given. Script is modified based on the comments, then only it goes for production. So we have evaluation process at the script level also. If required, the script is rewritten and re-evaluated at the script level. And then it goes for production. After production, the program, every program of CIT, whether it is an audio program or a video program, goes into the preview, where we have approximately 10 to 20 members minimum reviewing that content. So we have subject experts from the departments, we have producers, director there, we have script committee members there, everybody comes there together. And they see whether the content, the e-content which has been developed, is up to the mark for sharing it with the public. And also, when a new series is started, for example, in the last year, last 2 years, we CIT has been working on an AR series of geography. So when that series started, one or two programs were also taken to students for piloting. Piloting means it was tested on students, whether they like it, whether they understand from it. And then once the feedback was positive, then the next program of that series were created. So this I'm telling you because we have to understand that the process of evaluation is important. And it is not just important when one teacher is working, it is also important when content is being created at a national level. So we are not missing on that aspect. Just start a screen share, and then we will discuss about the evaluation in detail. I hope my screen is visible to all of you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So first of all, as I have already discussed, the need for e-content evaluation, then we have to focus on these three major parameters. The first is we should understand what an e-content is. So we should know what we are going to evaluate, what we call a content when we call any content as e-content. Why do we need to evaluate these e-content and how they should be evaluated? The process, the method, the tools to evaluate these e-content. So the first is, what is an e-content? So if I ask you what type of digital content you use in the classroom, then you might come up with the idea, audio, video, images, and all those things. So all these are considered as e-content. Now, if you see on the slide, you can understand that how many type of e-content are there. And this list is also not exhaustive. You can add many more types of digital content in this list. So to start with, visual, that is image or graphics both, then text, any text document, applications, games, e-journals, database, presentations, even portfolios, the way journals are there, we have personal portfolios and we have portfolios of students, we can have portfolio for the class performance, these all could be considered as e-content. Then we have audio programs, video programs, simulations. Simulation is when we are in a simulated environment. For example, I have to give a driving test and I am not giving it on the real car. A simulator of car has been designed and I'm sitting in that and giving the test. Similarly, pilots get training on the aircraft simulator, not on the real aircraft, because real aircraft could be really costly. Similarly, you can see different digital games in the malls, which we see nowadays, that you are doing everything. You are handling the gear, you are handling the speed, you are handling the steering and everything. They are also simulated games. So we are actually living that experience, that is simulation. Then animation, interactives. Animation, we all know very well. Today you had a detailed session on animation. Then we have interactives. Interactives means when we are able to interact with certain e-content. You have discussed about H5P. You can create interactive content. We have discussed today about different quizzes, platforms where we are going to engage with the quiz. So that is interactive resources. Then ebooks, immersive content, augmented reality and virtual reality. You visited the virtual reality labs. You had your session yesterday on that. So all this is considered as e-content. Apart from this, if you can think of any other e-content, that can also be considered under this list of e-contents. Now we have understood what we need to evaluate. So these are the types of e-content which needs to be evaluated. Now, why do we need to evaluate e-content? So if I say in simple terms, then if I ask you this in simple terms, you will say that the content should be useful for the children. The children should be able to learn through that content. These should be some common answers which we know. But we have much more than that as a reason for evaluating any digital content. First is reliability and validity. These are very technical terms. These are actually a research-based term. So reliability means the content is teaching and helping student learn something. And most of the students are learning that particular thing through that content. Say, for example, through a map, every child, maybe not fully, but is learning 80% of the points covered in that map. This is the reliability. What is validity? Validity means if I am teaching something, say, for example, I am telling you about evaluation of content, but I am not covering all the content, then my session would not be valid because I am not touching upon all the elements of e-content evaluation. Say, for example, in your subject-specific tools, you were in mathematics. The session is designed for mathematics. You attend the session and you find out that the tools which are being displayed are common tools. They are not specific to mathematics. Then this is not a valid session. But if you think you are in a mathematics session and two or three good tools of mathematics are being taught or explained or demonstrated, then that is a valid session. So similarly, the content which we need to teach has been covered in that e-content is the validity of the particular resource. Now, next is appropriateness as per the nature of content and the method of teaching. So now here we are coming on to the pedagogical aspect of the digital content. You are all teachers. You know the type of content, the subject of the content, and the methods of teaching for teaching that type of content or that type teaching that particular subject. So you are well aware of that. And in the digital resource, in the e-content also, you have to carefully analyze that we are the presenter is using appropriate methods of teaching and the content has been covered appropriately. So if I say for a very interesting topic where we can learn through an activity, I am giving a lecture, then that method is not appropriate. So this way we have to analyze what is the pedagogical approach which we need to use in teaching particular content. That should be checked on a e-resource. Then the third point is cost effectiveness. This is very important because we get fascinated by the type of content and we start creating it. But we never understand and realize that whether spending so much of time and money and energy on creating that particular content will be valuable. That means if a very simple topic has to be taught, which a child can learn through real life examples, there is no need to create a very cost heavy resource. We may create a simple resource for that because that is a simple concept and can easily be learned by the child. So in that case, we should be careful what we are creating and what kind of concept. So for example, for explaining any experiment, if we are creating a virtual lab, that is a cost effective medium because real lab is not available to the child. And here at least they will be able to perform an experiment. Even though it is a costly and time consuming affair, it is useful. But for teaching, say, for example, history, I am creating an experiment of war, then there is no point doing it because we are just going to spend so much money there, but the outcome would be similar to what we taught in the classroom. It could simply have been explained through a lecture method, or maybe only images or infographics could have been used to create such a scenario. So as a teacher, as an e-content creator, we should see whether it is cost effective, and cost doesn't only come with money, it comes with time and energy also. It should be effectively utilized. The next is licensing. You have covered licensing, open educational resources. What is a license? How a license is utilized? You have covered everything in your previous lectures. So here, when you are going to create a video and you need an image for that, you can go on to search on different online platforms and find out an image which is openly available. Or you can use a free and open source software to create your digital content, like we discussed about open source, the same OpenShot Video Editor, Audacity, H5P. All these are open source applications which can be utilized for creating digital content. So in appropriateness of the content, two points are left, which is context of the learner. You can see here context of the learner and available technology. So what is the context of the learner? We have to understand. Keeping in mind the learner, where the learner is coming from. Is he coming from a rural background, urban background, cosmopolitan background, or maybe laid-back area, keeping the experiences of that child in mind, one should create the content. Context also means the psychological level, the social gathering of that child, the language understanding, the previous knowledge, everything comes under the context of the learner. Then we have available technology. Available technology means you have created a very nice content, very fascinating, and you want to demonstrate it in the classroom, but you have never realized that your classroom does not have a power socket. You may carry your laptop, you may carry a screen also, but it doesn't have a power socket. It doesn't have a power socket nearby, or it doesn't have electricity at all. So you have to be careful before planning your digital content, what you are creating and how you are going to take it into the classroom. Now, next is if you, for example, you created a very nice video, high resolution, very beautifully done video, but the internet speed of your device or the device of children is very slow, and they are not even able to download that video. In that case, also the resource goes unused. So all these points we need to cater while we are going to evaluating any digital content. Now we come to the process or the method of reviewing or evaluating any digital content. Here we have certain consideration which needs to be thought of prior to reviewing any digital content. First is the target audience. Target audiences are learners. Sometimes we could have target audiences teachers also. For example, for this SRG, the content has been planned keeping in mind the teachers and their expertise. So we have to keep in mind the target audience, their age group, their previous knowledge, their social cultural background, their learning style, their languages, demographic information, their emotional development, overall social development, etc. Keeping and considering that in mind, then only we can plan our content. The next is content, which was reliability and validity we discussed, that comes under content. It talks about accuracy of content, which means whatever topic I'm planning to teach, the content has been properly covered according to that. So accuracy of the content, relevance of the content coverage should be appropriate, updated. For example, India, we have the boundaries change when J&K become a union territory. So we, while utilizing a map or bringing a map in the classroom, teachers should be careful to check that it is a new and updated information, updated map. The content should be aligned with the curriculum, spatial contiguity, temporal contiguity, scope, and depth of appropriateness to target audience. For example, we have certain topics which are taught at different levels. In class 6, also you will be talking about animal life. In 7th also you are talking about animal life. In 8th also you are talking about animal life. In 9th also you will be talking about animal life. So what kind of coverage, what kind of difficulty level, what is the depth of the content? You should be careful keeping in mind the age group and previous knowledge of the learner. We cannot cover everything of 3 years in one class. So it should be judicially designed that the content is in different classes. Then level of difficulty, integration of real-world experience, this I have already mentioned to you. Next comes is the pedagogical considerations. Here, the objective of teaching that particular or using that particular resource, method of delivering content, as I said, teaching methods, media selection. Now, there is one topic which could be covered by audio also or video also. How to decide you are going to use a video or audio? This we have discussed in our previous session yesterday, that keeping the topic in mind, for example, for the parts of flower, we will use a video program. For a program where we are not going into seeing the details, then we can go for opt for the audio program. So you should be very clear about media selection. Then the presentation format. We have discussed 7-8 presentation format like talk, interview, documentary, docudrama, drama. All this you have to decide based on your content that which presentation format you will use. It should be free from biases, contextually designed. You are knowing that the government is very much interested in regional language learning and regional examples, regional syllabi, so that learners are more comfortable in learning through their regional experiences rather than the experiences that felt at Delhi would be applied to others. No, it should be state-wise planned according to their needs. Then it should have multiple modes of assessment which could help you to understand whether the content you have created is useful or not. Then comes the presentation of the program. Aesthetically, it should be beautiful. It should be engaging. Literary and social values. We should never avoid, even if we are creating a content for any subject, science or mathematics, the social values should be dealt with properly in that program. Innovation, universal design of learning, all these shall be taken care of, and also care should be taken for specially abled children so that they can learn through these resources. We should also be careful about gender equality in the video, in the audio, or any kind of content which we are creating. Then we have technical features. Here comes the we are reaching towards the end, and important thing is coming, but in digital content, content is the master. Then comes the technical glitches like file format, which is useful, MP4 or MP3, which can be run anywhere and everywhere, shall be opted. Other aspects like reusability, the metadata of the resource shall also be prepared. Interoperability means it should be accessible through different devices, accessibility, license, duration, everything shall be taken care of in the technical features. Then we have got the administrative consideration, the discussion we had regarding the cost effectiveness will be dealt here in administrative consideration. Cost of the resource, delivery mechanism, how it will be delivered, other services required for using that particular resource should also be taken care of while reviewing the resource. And also one important point which I want to cover here is that the content should also include the constitutional value. It should also respect the constitutional values, the basic rights and duties of the citizens of India, so that we are indirectly inculcating those values in our learners also. Now, how it should be evaluated, the process we are discussing. So we need to have a tool for e-content evaluation, which can help us to evaluate the content and based on these parameters which we have discussed. So now we have different parameters for e-content evaluation, which I will show you from the directly website. Then we have guidelines for e-content development. So when we are creating e-content, then also we should be careful about the steps to create the e-content, and a booklet has been prepared by CIET for giving these guidelines on e-content development that we will be seeing just after this presentation. Now, when you are evaluating or when you are developing any digital content, at CIET we focus on following this instructional design model that is called ADDIE. ADDIE means A is for analyze, D is for design. The second D denotes development, I denotes implementation, and E is for evaluation. E is placed at the end, but it doesn't mean that it is not there in other steps. ADDIE allows us for placing evaluation at every step. Once you have analyzed what content you have prepared, what is the media you are going to select, what is the presentation format you are going to keep, and everything you have discussed, then you can get it reviewed by the your colleagues or the experts, that whether what we have thought is right or not, or do we need to improve upon it. After the approval, then only the designing stage comes. Here in designing stage, we can plan and we can collect the relevant information related to the digital content we are going to prepare. The draft script can also be prepared at this level so that what we are going to cover is available. After this also, you have to evaluate, you can get it evaluated. As I told, the script review committee is also there in the CIT, which is before development, which will work to review the script at the very basic level. Once it is reviewed and approved, then only it should go for the actual development of the digital content. Development here means recording, video recording, editing, creation of any infographics or graphics, any other resource which you want to put in, everything will be added at this stage and a final product will be created. Once it is created, it will be evaluated by the expert and also it will be implemented on the target group. And the implementation results will be evaluated whether it has reached properly, the children have got benefited from it or not. So this is the basic process of creating digital content. This is the basic model which we follow at CIT for creating digital content. Similarly, different edtech companies, education technology companies, which are creating digital content, are also using different instructional design models for creating their digital content. So it basically gives you a direction to move in and a stepwise evaluation mechanism so that you don't go wrong anywhere. With this, this model helps us to learn more about the content creation. Now I will be taking you to the CIET website. You can simply type ciet.nic.in. So here you can see we have a pull-off button, which is resources. You can come here and you can see here eContent guidelines, which I mentioned just in the presentation. Here we have got two guidelines available. Guidelines for the development of e-content for children with disabilities, for children who are specially abled. Then we have guidelines for development of e-content for school and teacher education. So generally we are referring to this right now, but you may also go through this for making your content universally designed for learning. So what has been covered in this, we will just see it here. Now you can see these are the guidelines for digital content. So first of all, it is the same type of e-content which we are referring to. Then process of developing e-content using ADDIE. And then for every step, need analysis. The first was analysis. In that, we are doing need analysis and context analysis. Everything is given in detail for you to understand which kind of analysis, how to do that analysis is given here. Then we have learner analysis and content analysis. This we all have discussed in the presentation. The second is the design. Here we are going to design the instructional strategy. It includes pedagogical consideration, how it will be created, the learning objectives, the structure of the content, what it would be, etc. are covered here in this stage. Then we have the development. Here we are starting developing the content, and then we have the testing of the content with the learners and the review by the expert. So everything is covered at these stages. This is a guideline document. This is a slightly longer document. You can go through it when you have time, and you can also utilize it when you are creating any digital content, or also share with your state authorities that we can use this document as a Bible for creating digital content. Now I'll move on to the next thing. We discussed the parameters for digital for the evaluation. Now we will see exactly how to do it. So here in the same resource section, you can go on to eContent evaluation. Once you click here, you will find out so many things. First is the eContent evaluation tool. Second is the parameters for eContent evaluation. Then assessment tool, we have this repeat. And then first we will see the parameters for eContent evaluation. So here, the first is factual accuracy. The content should be factually correct. Because if it is not factually correct, then the quality of resource does not matter. Even if it is the best quality video audio without any disturbance. But if it is factually wrong, then it is of no use. The second point is legal use of proprietary content. First of all, we try to use the content which is in public domain or in open source. Otherwise, if you are using any proprietary content, then the proper permission should be taken off for that using that particular content. Here you can see that the content piece should not use proprietary content which is unauthorized. Okay, so here we have to be very careful when we are downloading any image or any resource from the internet that whether it is allowed to use or not. Then the next is content piece free from technical glitch. That means the sound quality, general visibility, rendering, everything should be appropriate. That I am able to hear the sound of the content, I am able to see the visuals properly. That is the technical check of the content. Next is constitutional and statutory appropriateness of the content. So this basically means the point which I explained, that constitutional values should be considered in our digital content. We should not violate, the content should not violate any constitutional obligations which we have. Like, for example, we have certain fundamental rights, but we also have duties. So a learner should understand that we can exercise our rights, but we have to follow our duties also. And also, so say for example, we have 102 child policy in the country. We should follow that in our resource also. We should not show more than 2 children of any couple. That is also constitutional value which we are trying to inculcate through the resource. So all these points need to be taken care of. Then the next point is correspondence with the topics or subtopics covered in the textbook. So the relevance of the content with the textbook shall be checked and verified. If it is not relevant, then the content should be thought of before putting it to the school. We have pedagogical or andragogical structure. That content should be supported by relevant examples depending on the age group. Learning oriented, it should be cause and effect relation shall be explained wherever possible. It should go from concrete to abstract. If I'm explaining you something, one thing you should be able to physically see and touch, and then we should go to the abstract knowledge, which is not visible to us directly. The content should also attempt to bring out reflective thinking amongst learners. It should develop reflective thinking. It should also develop different domains of knowledge and learning, higher order skills. And it should follow maxims of teaching and learning. Maxims of teaching say from simple to difficult, from concrete to abstract, all these are maxims to teaching which should be followed in the digital content. It should be easy to difficult, simple to complex, concrete to abstract, whole to part or part to whole, depending on the type of digital content. Then we have language and comprehensibility. Content should have no grammatical errors, no errors at the language level. It should be presented in a way that it is understandable to that level of learner, that age group of learners. It is not like it's very good. We want to showcase our English language to the children. We should get down to the level of the child and then should use the language appropriately, which a child can understand. Then the format of content presentation. Format, we have already discussed that which kind of, it should be a group discussion, it should be an interview, it should be a documentary, it should be a vox populi, what it should be. You should decide the format of the content presentation in advance. Then comes the pace of the program, that is the speed. Speed means, for example, if I am taking my session and I don't take pauses and I'm speaking at very much high speed, then you won't be able to understand. The same should be applied to digital content, that the pace of the program, the content should move in an appropriate pace. It should not be slow that the child gets bored. It should not be fast that the child is unable to cope with that speed. Then the duration of the program. The duration shall be in accordance with the attention span of the learner. If the learner is young, smaller in age, then it should be very small. It should be 2 to 5 minute content. If the learner is maybe at a middle level, then the content could go for 10 to 15 minutes. If the child is at the higher level, then the content can go beyond that also, but not more than 30 minutes, because then it becomes slightly boring for the learner to understand from that content. Now, if you see here, there are certain notes. If you focus on that, a content piece shall be deemed fit for consumption when it has scored yes in the first 4 parameters. What were the first 4 parameters? That is factual accuracy. I said, if the content is not factually correct, then you should not even review the content further. Actually, it should be correct. Legal use of proprietary content or no use of proprietary content. No technical glitches, and constitutional and statutory appropriateness shall also be checked. And if the content is found to be lagging in these 4 areas, then it should not further be reviewed at all. Next is, curation shall also be terminated for a content piece if it has scored no in the first 4 curation that I have already told. I think that I have already discussed with you. So these were the parameters for e-content evaluation. Now, we have got a tool for e-content evaluation. We can check that. This tool would be based on what we have already discussed in the parameters. So now you can see here, first is factual accuracy. Here detail is not given. This has been made slightly simplified, but the items remains the same. Legal use of proprietary content, technical glitches, constitutional values, correspondence with the topic, pedagogic and andragogic structure, language, format, pace, and duration. And based on this, the content shall be reviewed. In this way, you can also become a digital content evaluator. You can, once you are done with this course, your name can also be added to this list so that you can also evaluate content at national level for supporting the cause of learning and reaching out to the children with good quality content. Now, okay, so I have I can see a few chats in the chat box. The first is, please give one module on entire training program. Also provide how to develop e-content module. So on the entire training program, the team will work for that. they will answer. And how to develop e-content module is the process remains the same guidelines for creating e-content, which I have just shown you on the CIET website. You can follow those steps and create your digital content. Okay, so next is for the hands-on session that you can request in your later days when you have to give your action plan. You can tell about that to the authorities for all your requests. Any other questions for you till now on the evaluation part? I can take your questions for 5 minutes and then we will do one. We will see one digital content and we will try to evaluate that content on our own in this class. No questions? Everything understood here or everything is all clear? Nothing is like in your head, everything is clear from there. Are you all here in the session or just logged in and left the session somewhere in between? Because
they may have understood everything, you have explained everything so well that they do not have any query.
How to choose contents for CWSM student. So, sir, depending on the need of the child, you should choose the content. We cannot generalize that which content you should use. We have certain content in sign language on Diksha, which can be used for children who are hearing impaired. So similarly, we can have different devices and different type of content for different skill set. Okay, so now I'm going to play a video here. Yes.
Ma'am, this is from Ellen Murthy from Andaman Nicobar Islands.
Yes, sir.
These islands having the multi-language, multi-medium is there. But we can say the Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu is only one language, unique language. They, due to mini India, the Andaman Nicobar Islands having multi-languages. So how in this situation we inculcate this e-content evaluation or assess?
Sir, e-content evaluation, when you are creating a digital content, you are creating in any one language. It could have been translated or a new content can be created in the other language you require. Say, for example, I understand that we have Bangla speaking community, we have Tamil community also there, we have Hindi belt also there. So I can understand this, but you have to create the content. You can also use content which is being developed by the states of speaking these languages and evaluate it by the expert of those particular languages and use it for the learners.
We are doing same thing, whatever you are telling, we are doing like that. But we are expending more energy, more economic, more time. So any strategy taking CIP, I just discussion. I want to discuss so with you.
You can, you can collaborate with the states also. You can take the verified and reviewed content from the states, which is already being used in the schools in that particular state. So in that way, you will not have to do the evaluation process again. So that could be one strategy to collaborate with different state governments so that they can help you. Or for the English and Hindi language, because that is also there in Andaman, you can take the content from CIT or Diksha portal also for using it directly in your classrooms.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Then we had one more question. Okay, ma'am, you said if the factual accuracy is not up to the mark, then the rest of the content. No, if the factual accuracy is lacking, if it is a small mistake, you can mention it for the review, revise of the content. If it has more errors or factually quite wrong, then you should not go for reviewing it any further and the content should be rejected at the first level, because factual accuracy is the most important element in when we are talking about digital content. So now I will play one audio resource here. You can listen to this resource and then now I will not speak. You will speak your observations on that particular resource based on the parameters which we have discussed for e-content evaluation. So just I am sharing my screen.
CIET NCERT presents the series of English stories, Learning to Listen and Listening to Learn.
Is it audible to all the resource which I have played? Okay. Okay.
Friends, let's listen to this program and enjoy.
Is a very small story. It usually has animal characters assuming roles. Now, listen to some fables and think about the characters you meet there. The fox who thought he was clever. One day a fox told a cat, "You know, I'm very clever. I know hundreds of tricks, so my enemies can't catch me." The cat smiled and said, "I know only one way." Just then they heard the dogs bark and saw some men. The cat quickly climbed up a tree and hid in the branches. The fox began to think. He could not decide on the way of escape. It was too late. The dogs and men caught the fox and killed it. The cock found a pearl but was unhappy. A cock was walking up and down a farm looking for food. He was hungry and had not got even a single grain since morning. Suddenly, he saw something white and shining in the hay. "Ho ho," cried he, "that's for me," and he picked it up. "Oh, it's not food," he cried out. He found it was a pearl and threw it away in disgust. "I need food," he said. "What will I do with a pearl?" The big fat fishes. There were a lot of fishes in the sea. The big fishes were proud of their size. They said, "We are the terror of the sea. Everyone is afraid of us, but we are not afraid of anyone." They often ate up the small fishes. The small fishes tried to fight them. The big fishes said, "Do not waste your strength. You cannot fight. We can easily catch you." One day, a fisherman threw a net into the sea. The net was large and strong. The big fishes were caught, but the little fishes escaped through the holes. Discuss the fables with your friend. How were the characters and actions in them? What do you feel about them? Share such stories, fables that you know with your class.
Some fables. Now listen to some fables and think about the characters you meet there.
Okay, I am going to stop here this audio. We can continue after these three fable discussion is done. So we have heard three fables in this audio program. Now you give your reviews, you evaluate it based on the parameters. If I say factual accuracy, do you think it is factually correct for the maybe the younger kids? These are very small fables for maybe the primary kids. Is it appropriate? The content is okay? Do you think so? Now you have to speak. All of you, I request you to, so you can speak or you can write in the chat, whichever is convenient to you. Yes, 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 yes. Okay, so the first is, we covered that it is appropriate for the younger kids to understand these fables. Okay, and any other observations on different parameters of which we have discussed? I will just open the tool in front of you so that you can give your inputs based on that.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon.
Madam, at the same time, all these three stories are going to give some moral to the children.
That you have to tell right now. You as a teacher, what do you think about it?
Where the teacher has to see that the children will be able to understand it and they will be able to reveal it, what moral they are able to get with this particular fables.
Yes. Now, see, the storytelling is an important component of learning, language learning, and also learning other experiences in the younger ages, maybe class 1 to 4 or 5, because it is not just one story we are talking about. We are talking about different characters. We are acquainting them with different animals, their traits as an animal, different food items, different plants around us. We are orienting them on different matters. So a teacher can decide upon it that which aspect they are focusing. A child may only notice something very strange in that story, which the other child will not notice. And as you mentioned about three, you may play one story at a time, or you may edit it as a one story. So that could be a way of a teacher of handling particular digital content. So now the second point is factual accuracy. You all said yes. The second is legal use of proprietary content. This content has been created in-house in CIT, so there is no legal permission problem as such. We can directly go about using it because every content on Diksha is available for free use, free and open use. Then content is free from technical glitches. Do you think there was any technical glitch in that content? Any technical glitch you could observe?
All are included in the same picture.
Because it is an audio program, the video is just given for our orientation when we are uploading it on YouTube. Otherwise, it is an audio content. Yes, content is very clear voice. There was no music was loud, no distraction was there in the content. Constitutional and statutory appropriateness, was it defaming anybody, any community, or was it not following any constitutional values? No. So it was properly according to the constitutional values also. Then correspondence with the topic and subtopic and learning outcome. Now, here comes the role of the teacher that in the audio, it was told that it is listening to learn and learning to listen. So there is one component when we talk about story. One is hearing. We are hearing the story. We are not listening. Listening is always with comprehension. So here we are focusing on listening to learn and learning to listen. Here we are developing the faculty of listening amongst the children and also developing the faculty of learning through listening. So there were two components which were dealt in this audio, which were very clearly dealt and we could see easily through that program. Then pedagogic and andragogic structure. Yes, the audio was, one story was very small, maybe just one and a half minute. So that means bite-sized content could be very useful for the younger children. The story is stated, the task is done. We don't have to play a 30-minute content in the classroom. Even if we want to do two stories, we can take a break in one story and then we can start the second story. So pedagogically also the approach was correct. If you think, yes, sir.
This also readiness giving the children, we can make the readiness of the learning
yes.
by these tables and strengthening
yes.
the, we can stimulate to learn and we can strengthen the affective domain also because we are belongs to the teaching nature. So we have, we are readying, we are strengthening the affective domain as well as cognitive domain.
Very right, sir. That is what I said. Here the input of teacher would come. The teacher can take this story from here to anywhere he or she wants. They can take it to their bonding with the nature, their bonding with the animals around us, their affection for these different living beings, and also for being sharp enough to take a decision on time. Say, for example, in case of the cat and the fox, the cat could decide and could save her life. So this sharp-mindedness, decision-making capability could have been taught through the same story. So it is up to a teacher that how we are going to, what input we can bring out from the story. And also one important thing comes here is, teacher should not keep on speaking. Like now, sir has given us a great input. Teacher should also ask the student that what did you understand? In this way, the student will come up with different ideas and you will be surprised that you would have never thought about those ideas when you were discussing the poem or the story. So that way, you should give chance to learners to speak. Or also, you can ask them to extend the story. For example, the fox was killed. Cat saw. Now, extend the story. The children can make new story just taking that point. This will enhance their thinking skill. This will enhance their story narrating skill. So you can give them optimum opportunities using one single small resource. Language and comprehensibility, of course, here listening skill, hearing capability, learning skill is all enhanced. Language is enhanced. You can also bring out small grammatical elements here. You can discuss about maybe entering synonym also sometimes. Depending on the level of the learner, you can bring out many things from just one single fable and teach them all those concepts through this. Format of the content, presentation appropriate for age, class and level. As far as I am seeing the hearing to the program, it looks appropriate. If you have any consideration for this, you can also say it. You can talk about it. You can write in the chat. Pace of the program was also perfect because it was a small story, very softly narrated. It was not at all fast paced and very useful for these learners. Duration, of course, was appropriate because very small duration for the younger kids. But if you are dealing with the higher level kids, maybe for class 5th, this could have been a really small resource. For class 5th, we could have a little longer story. So depending on the class, we can decide that the length, what should be the length of the program, we can decide. So these were the, this is the way we are going to evaluate any digital content, the way we did just now. So you can also do it as a teacher when you are going to see, for example, you go to YouTube, you find out a very good video, just evaluate it on these parameters. Because we need to build all these parameters in our students also, that they should learn the constitutional value, they should study the correct content, and then only we will be able to bring out quality content for the learners. Now you can share your comments also, if any, regarding this program. This program is uploaded on Diksha. You can also access this program or you can access more programs and use them in your classroom for teaching and learning. Strengthening their language skills. Yes, it aims at strengthening the language skills. Fables apt for the lesson or topic should be selected. Yes, in the lower classes, if you look at the chapters, they are based on the fables itself. So then it can become very useful for the learners to understand through this audio. From the audio, they also get to know about the correct pronunciation of the words. But before that, you should check whether the pronunciation is correct or not. You should not also bring something which has wrong pronunciation to the classroom so that they are not getting wrong or mispronounced content in front of them. Yes, any other comments? If not, then this is it from my side, Nidhi. I am done with the session. If any questions are there, we can take up.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And as I can also see in the chat box that whatever queries they had or whatever discussion participants wanted to, they have already done side by side. Still, if any question is yet to be asked, please ask either by writing in the chat box or by raising your virtual hand.
Madam, I am Ganeshan from Pondicherry, 232-430. Internet interrupted, madam. Please send administration, madam.
Sorry, sir, I could not understand. What did you say? Ganeshani, sir, you can write in the chat box. I could not understand what you said. Well, thank you very much for your questions and your discussion with me during this session. Because the discussion or the question only tell us that whether we have been able to reach out to you properly or not. Because sometimes the language barrier, sometimes the speed barrier may be there. So your questioning, your comments always help us to understand that. Thank you very much for this very interactive session. We will meet again sometime in some other session. Thank you.